Good morning, OCV. Glad you're here this morning. Let's get ready to worship the Lord. Let's stand with Chris and Charity and get ready to worship.
A hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. The darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me. Storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Were the Word at the beginning, one with God the Lord most. hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. And you have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring the praise of your glory.
Jesus, for your beautiful, wonderful, powerful name. God, we're so grateful for you, for the love that you show us, for the mercy you pour out on us every day. Thank you, Jesus.
old-fashioned way. Check. All right. Never fails. Sound check. Then something goes wrong. All right, couple quick things to share this morning. First of all, if you're here for the first time, welcome. If you're here for the first time in a long time, glad to have you back. And if you're here every week, we're so glad you are. And just going to make a couple quick announcements. First thing, everyone who's helping with kids, or anyone who's interested in helping with kids, there's going to be a kids catered lunch right after worship on Sunday, November 14th. And it's a really great chance for what we can celebrate you all, and at the same time we can convey some of the changing stuff that's happening here. And it's also a great time if you're interested at all in on-ramping on to help. That's a great time to come. So mark your calendars, November 14th, right after. And I'm going to make a couple other quick, just kind of ways to plug in announcements. There's so many things to be grateful for. I mean, I just can't get over how many people got their fingerprints to help with kids, and how, you know, it's great to have food and coffee again, and it's so good. And I'll tell you, how many here like having coffee out there? Right? How many here like having a friendly face at the door or at the table or in the parking lot if you're new? How many here like that, right? How many here like the fact that someone when you were little told you about Jesus, if that happened to you, right? Yeah. And all of those things, we have so many great people, but we need a couple more, or we're going to run the risk of burning folks out. Like, I think, Sue, I think your team needs a couple more. Yeah, and Sue has it all laid out, so if you're willing to just come in, turn the coffee pot on, and pour it in the stuff, you can do it. You know, kids needs a couple more, Garrett needs a couple more, right? And he has a sign-up sheet at that table, is that right? All these things actually matter a lot to help people feel loved when they come in these doors, right? Because we want coming in these doors to feel different than coming in any other doors in this community. Right? It should feel, if anything, like coming in your own home front door. That's what we want to feel like. So honestly, if you're not plugged in some way, or if you're plugged in somewhere like once every 6 weeks and you're willing to say, hey, I'll make coffee every so often, plug in somewhere else, we could really use it, and it's going to really bless people. All right, one more thing, announcement. I don't know if they're able to watch this morning, but keep praying for Pastor Mark. His fever's still there. It's gone down, but he's in UPMC Northwest with some sort of infection. They can't figure out exactly what it is yet. So pray for Mark. It's been a little worrisome the last couple days, so keep praying. Let me check my notes here so I'm not missing anything. You ever have that thing where, like, when one thing goes a little bit off, it sets you off, right? So when my lapel mic doesn't work, it's just like, it's like a crash. All right. Oh, this is one I forgot. Two more, but this one I forgot. The other one I was going to get to. The one I forgot is this. So we are like super close to signing a little thing on a women's retreat at the castle in April. And we're super excited about that. We have been waiting to get in at the castle, which is booked every weekend of the year, for like 3 years. And so April 29th through 30th, you can pencil that in. We're going to finalize it this week. So just so you know, April's going to be retreat season because the youth retreat is the weekend before. But when the castle says we have a weekend open, you spring on it. So women's retreat, Amy's going to be telling you more about that coming up. And then do keep praying for Kayla's family and the passing of her brother. And it's just been a tough week for the whole family, for Rich Weiss and Elaine, for everyone in the family. So let's go to prayer now. Come, Holy Spirit. God, we come to you today with things we're celebrating and with things that hurt, with joys and with pains. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would meet us here this morning. Lord, I pray that you would minister in the way only you can. I pray that our hearts would be sensitive to your word, but also to your voice, to the promptings that you put in our spirit. Lord, we do pray for Mark. We pray that you'd heal his body this morning. Holy Spirit, right now, just start rooting out that infection even more. Bring his fever down. Give Mark and Diana peace this morning. We pray for everyone who's sick, who's grieving a loss. We especially think of the Weiss family this morning. We pray that you would be their peace. And God, I pray that you would pour out your blessings and goodness on your people in this church family here and in every single church in our region. Lord, help us to be for you and for your Big C Church everywhere, that we are just celebrating the good wherever we find it. Now speak through your word. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. So over the last few weeks, we've been in a sermon series on the parables, kingdom stories as we've called them. And we've learned all kinds of things. And forgive me when I review, but you know, if you're in and out, and if I think these are some important things, it doesn't hurt to just hear them, right? Positive reinforcement. I think there was something in my educational degree at some point that said repetition actually helps people learn. So what have we learned about the kingdom? We've learned the what of the kingdom. You know, this idea that the kingdom is now and not yet, right? This idea of the seeds and the wheat, that there's good and bad, and they're kind of at war. We know the good's going to win. God is more powerful. It's not an equal fight. But right now, before that final harvest, there's a lot of pain, and there's a lot of good, bad things that happen even to good people. We've learned a bit about how the kingdom's come. You know, everyone in Jerusalem wanted the kingdom to come like an emperor to drive out Caesar, and yet the kingdom comes like a mustard seed. It starts small and grows. It comes like leaven, that you can't even fully understand how it works its way through everything. We've also learned about what the king of this kingdom is like. That he's just and loving. And last week, we learned that he's like a father looking for his son's return and generous beyond comprehension in his grace and his love. He's the father who, what, sees and then runs up and then hugs and kisses and throws a party, tells everyone about it. Today we're going to spend another week on this kind of unbounded generosity of God. And we're going to explore its implications for us, for you and for me. So last week we looked at a parable that only shows up in Luke's gospel. This week we're going to look at a parable that only shows up in Matthew's gospel. So if you turn to Matthew 18, we'll check it out. People say don't give you enough time. So I open my little bread on top of my cup so I'm not fumbling with it, right? Multitasking here. Okay. So what you'll notice if you look back in the headings, if your Bible has headings, some do, some don't. What you'll notice if you look back is that this comes not that long after the parable of the lost sheep, which is also where the story of the prodigal son comes in Luke, right? It's the story of this one who's willing to go seek out and save the lost. Well, this, instead of the parable of the prodigal son, in Matthew's gospel, we get the parable of the unforgiving servant. And we're going to pick up the reading in Matthew 18, verse 23. And let me just read the parable for us. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with the servants. And when he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And since he could not pay, his master ordered him to be sold and his wife and children and all that he had, and payment to be made. So the servant fell on his knees imploring him, "Have patience with me, and I'll pay you everything." And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. But when the same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him, he began to choke him, saying, "Pay what you owe." So his fellow servant fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, I'll pay you." But he refused, and he went and put him in prison until he should pay his debt. And when his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. So this is one of those fairly well-known parables, but it's not on the level of the prodigal son. Many of you probably have heard this. Some of you may not have ever heard this story before. What I want to do is look at the context of this parable to help us understand what's going on. Because honestly, if we think about the stories of Jesus, if we don't dig into the first century Jewish context that he's telling these stories in, we're going to miss stuff. And so today I want to focus on the context of this parable, and I think it will help us see just how powerful a kingdom story this is. So the first thing you need to know is that this parable is set in like Gentile kingdom. It's not set in a Jewish kingdom. How do we know? Well, we know that there's no hope of manumission, of releasing this debtor in prison. Jewish people, if you became a slave because of debt, it was like an indentured servitude. Within Jewish society, you would be manumitted or freed after 6 years. And on the death of your master, you'd be freed. God had written that into the Old Testament codes because he didn't want his people to be in perpetual servitude or bondage to anybody. They already knew what that was like, right, in Egypt, and he didn't want that again. So we know we're dealing with a Gentile king who is willing to put someone in prison for a long time. And by the way, if you're reading from the ESV, which I am, you might see that it says in verse 34, his master delivered him to the jailers. And you might see a little number by that. And if you look down below, there's a little more disconcerting word there. It's torturers, which is the actual Greek. Like apparently the people that translated the ESV couldn't deal with that word. So they put jailers. But the actual thing they do here, which Jewish people didn't, that was part of their ethic, but Gentiles did, is they delivered this person over not just to jail, but to perpetual torture. All right, there you go. That's getting a little more real. So we know this is happening in Gentile court. What about the amount of debt? Because it's hard for us when we read this story. We're like, oh, he owed a lot. This I didn't owe a lot. And, we can see on a basic like scale of justice, it doesn't seem like a good idea what the unforgiving servant did. But I don't think we have, I know I didn't, until I really started looking into this, any concept of how much debt this forgiven servant owed. So let me just lay out what's going on here. So a talent, he owes what, 10,000 talents. A talent was originally a measurement for weight. And usually, when we get into talent as a monetary value, it refers to silver. And it's a measurement of silver that's equal to about 6,000 denarii. Now, that means nothing to us, but let me tell you a little more. Do you remember from last week when we talked about the laborers that got hired, some at the morning, some at 9 o'clock, some at noon, some at 3, and they all got a denarii, right? And that is 1 day's work for a laborer at this time. So you can basically say, if you get one denarii, you have 1 day's work. So if we have 1 talent of silver equaling 6,000 of these, think about that. 1 talent of silver is worth 19.1 years of work. Okay, so then think about this. 10,000 talents is worth what? 191,693 years of work. That is a long lifespan. In today's value, this amount is worth millions, perhaps billions of dollars. In fact, the historian Josephus, when he tells us about Jewish history, he says that when Pompey came up from Egypt and took control of all of Israel, the amount he took from them was actually 10,000 talents from the entire nation. That was the debt of the nation. So if one nation was able to come up with this, but could one person? It was beyond the scope, right? And he says, just let me work a little more and I'll come up with it. That's a lot of days of work to come up with that, right? Well, then the other thing that helps us get a grip on what is being said here by Jesus is the fact that it's not just that this, if we do the math, is an amazing, immense amount of debt that's owed. It's like inconceivable how someone would be able to rack up that much debt. But he has, and he owes it. Well, the other thing you need to know is that the largest unit of money that they knew of was what? The talent. And the largest number that you could say in Greek was, guess what? 10,000. Myrias. So Jesus is not only saying like some large amount, but he's actually saying the largest thing you can think of, the largest amount of money, the largest number we can say in Greek, this is how much you owe. It's basically like when we say zillions and zillions. It's beyond our ability to think about. You getting the picture Jesus is painting here? This person owed a debt he could never in thousands of lifetimes pay. It was beyond his ability to pay. Compare this to the debt of the other servant. 100 denarii. About 100 days of work. 3 months of work. That is a lot, but it's doable. He could have tucked away, saved, and over a certain amount of time, saved this up. But he wasn't given the chance, right? The forgiven servant decided to throw him for a much, 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 like one to like 600,000th less debt to lock him up. So the first servant's debt is immense. But the generosity that he receives from the king is also immense. If he had an insurmountable debt, he received an unimaginable amount of generosity. This parable is about the generosity of God. But it's also about what that generosity does to us, the recipient. And there's an imperative here for us. The imperative is that we, being forgiven, live as forgiving people. So we get that. But the immediate textual context actually makes that point even stronger. You wouldn't have to have anything else than what I just told you. So if you were, you know, a first century Jew and you heard this story, you wouldn't have to know anything but what I just said to know, oh my goodness, this is an incredibly generous king. And a servant who has no grasp on what that generosity meant to his life. But then if we dig a little more, you find that the story gets even stronger. So one of the things we do when we're interpreting the Bible, and you can do this at home when you're interpreting the Bible, is you always think about context within the chapter, within the section of the Bible you're reading, right? You can pick one verse out of the Bible, and you can't make it say anything you want, but you can make it say a lot of things, and some people do that, and they say some crazy stuff. And context is always important. So let's think about where this story comes. So we started at 23. Let's go back a few verses. So after the parable of the lost sheep in Matthew 18:10, and we read this a few weeks ago, we get this interesting section about what you should do if someone in the family of God, remember the gospel is written after the church has kind of come into existence, and they're dealing with conflict. They're like, oh yeah, remember Jesus said this thing about how to deal with conflict, right? And by the way, the disciples might have had their own bit of conflict when they were with Jesus. So we get some words about conflict here, right? And it's the standard thing. If you've been in a church a while, hopefully you've internalized this, but it's not always easy to still do. But it's this idea of someone sins against you, you go what? Go to Facebook. And then, right? If someone sins against you, you don't go to Facebook, you go to that person. And you talk with them. And then if it's not resolved, right, what do? You bring in someone else respected in the family of God and talk like a mediator. And then if that doesn't work, you go to the elders. And if that doesn't work, you have to say, and we've almost neglected church discipline completely in our modern society, but you have to say, for your good and for our good, we just have to take a break. And you just leave them to their sin if they've gone through all those stages and refuse help. So that's pretty serious about what to do with corporate kind of sin in a corporate body of believers. But then we get Peter. Gotta love him. He's always asking. these questions, maybe looking for a, looking to either be the star student or looking for an out. We're not always sure. Some of you know what that feels like. Peter comes up to Jesus right after this, and what's he say? Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? He's like, okay. But let's say we do this and he sins against me, you know, and we go through all these steps and like, okay, and then he does it again. Well, first of all, you see the interesting thing happened here is it's not a corporate thing with the body of Christ anymore. It's against me. It's personal. When someone sins against me, how many times, Jesus, should I forgive him? How about seven? Peter's, at this point, you almost can see him like, seven is pretty good, right? Pretty good. And Jesus does what he like always does. He's like, just wait, Peter. Here, the mic drop's coming, okay? He's like, I don't say to you seven times, but 77 times. Some of your translations will say 70 times seven. He's like, no. You think you're being generous. He's like, the generosity of God is so much bigger than what you can fathom. And then what? He tells the story about a generous king who gives generosity, and the one who receives it can't even steward even a little bit of that generosity out. There's a shift here. Jesus says, if it's a corporate thing in the body of Christ, deal with it this way. But if it's against you, there's basically no limit to how much Jesus asks us to forgive. 70 times 7, the perfect number, times the perfect number, 77. This idea of as long as you get sinned against, you keep forgiving. Now, in our human mind, that is tough. It's super tough. You need the Spirit of God to be able to even think about that. Fortunately, God gives them to us. Within this larger context that we get the feel for the choice we have between accepting and living out the generosity and forgiveness of God, or choosing to walk in our own kind of what I call vigilante vindictiveness or vigilante vengeance, which is so tempting, right? Like, there's probably a reason why we like all those Western shows and stuff that have these vigilante, like, sheriffs out there doing whatever. Vigilante justice is appealing to us because, like, we just want to be able to go rectify what's ever wrong on our own. We don't want to wait around. We want it now. These stories, both the story of the unforgiving servant and then the context within Peter's question and Jesus' answer, is seven times enough? And Jesus says, you're not even in the same ballpark. These remind us that we don't get to set the terms on our forgiveness amounts. We get to say thank you and live like we know we're forgiven. But here's the other thing. Whenever we interpret the Bible, we always also have to be thinking, and this is for you, because as you read the Bible on your own, these kind of questions come up and you need to know how to use the Bible on your own. It's not just me preaching. No, this Bible is for all of us. And all of you should be in it, and all of you should be reading it, and you should be coming across these things. I don't know what to do with it. And the first thing should be like, well, what comes before and what comes after, and where is this set? And then you should think about it this way. The Bible interprets the Bible. So the whole Bible tells a story that helps us make sense of the more obscure parts of the Bible. So when we come across something like this that sounds really hard, we need to think about the whole story of the Bible. So it's not just the immediate context, but it's the biblical Hebrew Bible context. Because remember, Jesus didn't have Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He didn't have Corinthians. What did he have? Genesis through Malachi. Right? He had the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. That was his scripture. That was the scripture that the people he was talking to knew. That was the scripture that the scribes and Pharisees knew. The Torah and the books of history and the books of prophecy and Proverbs and the that came after it. Well, if you want to know a text that actually sheds light on what Jesus says to Peter and on light on this story, you got to go the whole way back to almost the beginning. Turn with me, if you would, to Genesis 4. And I'm going to read, and it's a bit of a story, but it's one that you probably don't read a heck of a lot in your own devotions, and it's just worth hearing. And if you come from a family that has issues, this family has some issues, all right? So these two brothers, I'll give you a little backdrop. Cain and Abel, right? Their parents were kind of famous, Adam and Eve, kind of first. They kind of made some mistakes, and their kids had to deal with it. That never happens anymore, fortunately. And Cain and Abel are in the midst of making their own decisions. And Cain, as we'll find out, is pretty jealous of his brother. His brother seems to have a connection to God that he doesn't. And his jealousy turns into anger, and his anger turns into bitterness, and his bitterness turns into vigilante vengeance. Let's listen. Verse 8, Genesis 4. Cain spoke to Abel's brother, and when they were in the field, Cain rose up against his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord, by the way, the Lord had been gracious to Cain, and a few verses before he said, watch out, sin's crouching at the door. And Cain, kind of like you and I are tempted to do too, is like, whatever, God. And sin was crouching at the door, and he kills his own brother. The Lord said to Cain, where's your brother Abel? And he said, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, what have you done? The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground. And now you're cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it shall no longer yield to you its strength. You shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth. That's a pretty significant punishment. Remember, Cain was a gardener, a farmer. God says, the ground's not even going to work for you. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Behold, you've driven me today away from the ground, and from your face I shall be hidden. I shall be a fugitive and wander on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. Then the Lord said to him, not so. If anyone kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord put a mark on Cain, lest anyone who found him should attack him. Then Cain went away in the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Well, it's pretty happy so far. Let's keep going. Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch. And when he built a city, he called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. To Enoch was born Irad, and Irad fathered Mehujael, and Mehujael fathered Methushael, and Methushael fathered Lamech. And Lamech took two wives. The name of one was Ada, and the name of the other was Zillah. Ada bore Jabal. He was the father of those who dwell in tents and have livestock. His brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all who play the lyre and the pipe. Zillah also bore Tubal-Cain. He was the forger of all instruments of bronze and iron, and the sister of Tubal-Cain was Naamah. Now, so far, you're like, what in the world does this have to do, other than vengeance, with what we're talking about? Listen to this. Lamech said to his wives, Adla and Zillah, hear my voice. The wives of Lamech, listen to what I say. I've killed a man for wounding me. A young man, it can also be translated a boy, for striking me. If Cain's revenge is sevenfold, Lamech's revenge is 77-fold. Seven times sevenfold. You see, Jesus' audience knew this story like we don't. When you hear 77, it doesn't do anything for you. You might think like seven's a number in the Bible that's important and it's like perfection. When his audience heard this, they thought immediately Lamech. 77 times my vengeance will exceed anyone else's. I'll kill a man for striking me or even a boy. I don't care. Don't mess with me. Right? You see, God gave Cain punishment, but he also in his grace offered protection. Cain lives and his family lives. And then his great-great-grandson, apparently not learning much about God's grace, lives a life in which he boasts of his outrageous vengeance and temper. By the way, just as a side note, this is also the first time we see monogamous marriage breaking down. In addition to being a man of immense vengeance, he's a man who takes two wives. First time it happens in the Bible. Lamech is just like running his own life. No thank you, God, right? That's that kind of life. I'll take care of myself, God. My will be done, not thy will. That's Lamech. That's the spiritual context, the scriptural context that echoes through Jesus' words to Peter. And Peter would have known it. Jesus looks at him and basically says, you remember Lamech? Remember how he was going to take care of himself? Remember 77 times he would seek vengeance? Didn't matter if you're young or old, you don't mess with him, and he'll do it to, basically says, I'll never stop this vigilante vengeance. Jesus says, you are to be the exact opposite of that. If you can think of the most vengeance-filled person in the Old Testament, Lamech, who boasts of it proudly, he says to Peter, you're going to be the opposite of that. And then he tells him a story to help him understand why. Because Jesus is explicitly rejecting the trajectory that sin wants to chart in our heart. Like the king in the parable, God's forgiveness calls us to forgive accordingly, lavishly, generously. Then I want you to think of one more context that helps us interpret this story. We've already looked at the immediate passages of Scripture. We've looked at cultural, social context and how much the talent's worth. We've looked at even the scriptural context and where the story came from and what it was connected to all the way back at the very beginning. But there's another context that we need to think about, and it's context in the teaching of Jesus. You see, Jesus had a good bit to say about forgiveness. We're going to look at Matthew. Matthew's gospel tells us about it. It's in Matthew 6. This is one of our last places we're going today. This is right in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. And I'm going to read a passage that's going to sound pretty familiar. If Lamech sounded very unfamiliar, you should be right at home in this one. They ask him, how do we pray, right? He says, when you pray, don't heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they'll be heard by their many words. Don't be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Did you catch the only rider in that prayer? The only thing that was contingent on anything in that prayer? Jesus gives us a prayer that the church has prayed for thousands of years. They say, teach us to pray, and the master of all prayer and spirituality gives them a short little prayer that the church has been praying for 2,000 years, and there's only one rider in there that something hinges on. The rest is all up to God. We're just asking him for stuff, but there's one rider that is up to us, and it's this. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And if that's not enough, Jesus makes it more explicit in Matthew's gospel in the next two verses. He prays this prayer, and he doesn't talk to him about what daily bread means. He doesn't talk to him about what the kingdom asking for his will to be done means. The first thing he says is, for if you forgive others their trespasses. You see what he's getting at? If you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Jesus is pretty explicit. He doesn't say, you know, unless those trespasses reach this certain level of badness, and then you don't have to forgive them. In this prayer that the church has been praying for 2,000 years, that Jesus gives them, like, one prayer, like, how should we pray? He puts this in, and the only rider, the only thing that is contingent on us is this thing about God forgiving us and us forgiving others. And then, to make it more clear, Jesus says, don't miss this. Let me emphasize, if you don't forgive, you won't get forgiveness. There's not a footnote. There's not a caveat. There's not a, in this case, no. It's how it is. Between this prayer and the parable we examined today, we come into contact with the King of the kingdom, the King of all kings, the Lord of all creation. The one who loves us enough to seek us, the one who loves us enough to come for us, to lavish his love on us with immense generosity that we can't even fathom, with forgiveness that confounds anyone's ability get the supercomputer of the world going and start quantifying things, and you won't reach that level of the divide that God has crossed to forgive us. You can't mathematically get there. We can't come to grips with it. It's zillions on zillions if we're looking for an amount. God's generosity and forgiveness are beyond us. Just like that debt was beyond that servant's ability to pay, no matter how hard he worked. We can't hope to earn it. It's ridiculous to even hold out hope of earning God's forgiveness. All we can do is accept it and respond to it. And sometimes it's hard to accept, but it's even harder to respond to it. And that's what Jesus was getting about in this parable. If we, who have been forgiven so much, can't live graciously toward those who offend us, can't forgive the little mini debts that are committed against us, but are looking for vengeance, say, send them to jail, send them to the torturer, just like this guy did. I don't care. May they burn in hell. Jesus says, you know what? You were going to burn in hell. And guess what I did? I forgave you everything. Not because you could earn it, because you definitely couldn't, but because I loved you and I'm generous. Shouldn't you be generous like that? These are some of those sermons that I think are so clear you hardly need an application, but I want to just hit a couple points and just think about it a different way to drive this point home. Because I'm not going to lie, we are so good at rationalizing why I should not forgive this person, why I should not forgive this event. The first thing we have to do, if we're thinking about how this applies to me, is first of all, just accept, and if we haven't before, this is a great chance today, accept that the grace of God is for you. It's not just for those people. It's not for people that clean up nice. It's for you. Like, you owed a debt you couldn't pay. And unless you've come under Jesus' cross and said, forgive me, I know I can't do it on my own. I don't deserve heaven on my own. I don't deserve you on my own, but help me. Unless you've done that, you're still carrying that debt. And as ridiculous as it looked like for me to say, I'm going to pay off the U.S.'s national debt, that's how it's even more ridiculous for you to say, I'm going to pay off mine that I owe to God. You can't do it. It's all grace. But God is that good that he does it time after time if we humble our hearts. You know, even in that passage in Genesis, see, God's goodness isn't just in Jesus. God's been good the whole time. God's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The triune God, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit's always been here. Jesus just became human at a certain point to a certain woman named Mary. We're going to talk about it more in Advent in like a month. We're not there yet, but that happened. It's not going to unhappen. But Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, was always there before. Trinitarian Theology 101. God was the same. So guess what? God was the same generous God in Genesis. Did you catch that? What Lamech's sons did? It's called common grace. Did their dad deserve to have sons that started music and became like the founder of guilds of music, or the founder of guilds of metallurgy, or the founder of guilds and people who are good at livestock? No. They became cultural founders of these things, not because they deserved it, not because their dad deserved it. I mean, they're Cain's great-great-great grandsons, and they're still bearing this legacy, this family legacy, and yet God's pouring out goodness on them. It's called common grace. And he does it today. He pours out his gifts on people all over this place. And every single one of you have some of those gifts in your life. You didn't even do anything to deserve it, just God's that good. Maybe you're good at thinking through things. Maybe you're good with people. Maybe you're good at music. Maybe you're good at sports. Maybe you're good at math. Maybe you're good at just being a friend. And sure, you've worked at it, but God's given you gifts. Just like he gave Lamech's sons, of all people. If you're a musician, you better thank good old Jubal, right? Of all people, because he's that good. called common grace. And there's also this thing that's unique grace, and it looks like Jesus Christ coming to live a perfect life, to die on a cross, to be resurrected, to ascend to the right hand of God, where he, looking a heck of a lot like you and me, is in God's ear interceding for us right now. And he will come back, undeniably so, to judge the living and the dead at the end and set up the fullness of God's kingdom. We need both kinds of graces, and God pours them out. He gives gifts even to folks we might say, why is that person good at that? And that's because God loves that person, even if you don't, and he's going to give them a gift. But he's given all of us a chance to tap into the greatest gift, and that's Jesus Christ. Every other gift pales in comparison. It's like Jesus cancels our debt on that cross, debt we can't even fathom, but we have to be willing to give it up to him, to accept that grace, and that's where we normally stop, to, within the power of the Holy Spirit, give that grace in our forgiving hearts toward others. We can't earn sonship, but we can despise it. We can't earn our birthright in God's family, but we can sell it for a bowl of soup. And sometimes that bowl of soup looks like my revenge soup. Remember what Esau did? He sold his birthright for a bowl of soup, and then he regretted it. We hold on to that revenge, but I tell you what, on your deathbed, you're going to regret it. It's not worth it. It's a bowl of soup when you have a whole birthright there in front of you. Don't sell your birthright in God's family for a bowl of revenge. The unfathomable magnitude of our sin can't keep us from the depths of God's forgiveness and restoration, but our decision not to forgive, not to pay God's generosity forward in our interactions with others, that can. The cost of unforgiveness is steep if you take Jesus at his words. And it's not just, you know how we talk about forgiveness usually? It's like bitterness eats the container that holds it. This idea of like your unforgiveness is going to make your life worse. Well, yes, it will. But that's not the actual steepest cost of it. Your forgiveness has eternal unforgiveness has eternal consequences. The church has always talked about, for some reason we don't talk about this as actually an imperative anymore. We just say it'd be nice if you could forgive if you follow Jesus, but it's not an imperative. No, it's an imperative if you take Jesus at face value. In more than one place, and if you look at the story of Scripture, to claim to be under the king is to abide by the king's standards and to honor his character. Life in the kingdom is free, but it's not cheap. We can't earn it, but it does make demands on us. Any king makes demands. We just happen to be under, if you're under Jesus, the best, most just, most loving king you could ever imagine. And his demands are good and right and true. Think about what an amazing group of people, truly forgiving people would be. It's the kind of people that the world would crane its neck, would shake its head, would not understand, but would be deeply fascinated by and want to know more, and eventually the love would come through. Think about where we've seen it at work. June 17th, 2015. A young guy named Dylan Roof walks into a church in Charleston, South Carolina. In the middle of that Bible study, he murders numerous people. In this, at least this case, it was a racially motivated thing. And what did we see that community do? Forgive. To his face. At trial, we forgive you. If you Google that, you know how many articles you're going to find on forgiveness? Because the world cannot get it. But those people, Spirit was moving in them, and they got it. Let's take another example. October 2006. And granted, I'm giving you extreme examples, but I want to tell you, early on in this church's history, there was an incident where two people were kind of at odds, and they found forgiveness. And even in interpersonal relationships, it is such a beautiful thing when that happens, and it changes. And I think it changed the spiritual atmosphere here to have that happen. So it's not just these extreme examples, but sometimes the extreme ones do highlight the power of forgiveness. So just about this time, what is it, 15 years ago now, October 2006, there's a group of kids, the oldest of them is 13, boys and girls in a little Amish school out in Lancaster County, right? And a guy, married, 32, numerous kids of his own, walks in, sends the boys out and murders, shoots a number of people and murders the five people die, five girls in Amish, they're Amish. If you read about that story, what's going to stand out to you? I mean, there's all kinds of stories like that, right, anymore, like graphic shootings. You know what stands out about that story is the forgiveness that that family gets offered by the Amish community in Lancaster. So here's how it goes down. The mom, imagine being a parent, right? The mom hears about this on the radio. She gets to her son's house. The police are there. She knows. And her husband says, we can never live here again. We have to move. Can you imagine having the world's watching eye on you as a parent? And so they set up this quick funeral. It's private. They don't invite anybody for their son because it's still their son that dies. And who comes? The Amish come to that funeral. And who brings things to their house to eat? The Amish. And who eventually builds an addition on this woman's house that over the door of it says forgiven? And who allows this woman into their life to help heal her? And there's a little girl who was shot in the head and is basically a vegetable on a feeding tube. And now this woman, for years and years, would go every Thursday and bathe her and read to her. And the family would let her in. Why? Because forgiveness is the most powerful thing that we can possibly do as Christians. And this Amish community got it. And you know, if you read about it, because the world, that you read USA Today, you read anything about this, they'll say, how can you forgive? And isn't it, it's just not even mentally healthy to forgive so quick, and how can you do it? And you know what they say? We've been praying this little prayer. And it says that if we don't forgive, God won't forgive us. So we're going to be forgiving people. And the people writing the article are like, well, we're still not sure. But this is what they say. God doesn't give us any caveats. He says, forgive. He says, you've received the generosity you can't even fathom, so I don't want to hear it. Forgive. Hey, this isn't saying let the next person that's going to put you in harm's way come in your house. No way. But forgive what happened. Gentle as doves, wise as serpents. Don't put yourself in harm's way, but forgive. It's not a suggestion. It's a Christian imperative. You've been given a gift. And the only thing you're called to do is pay that gift forward. Let's pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Pray you put your finger on the parts of our hearts that we don't trust you enough to give to you, where we hold on to vengeance and revenge and bitterness. And Holy Spirit, I pray that today would be a day of freedom in this house and in these families. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And in just kind of a solemn moment, let's have the band come up. We're going to go to communion. And we're going to open up prayer in that back corner, back where Rita's standing. Thank you. And I just want you to stay in that place with God. You know, don't trust yourself. We're so good at rationalization. Don't leave that place with God. If he's putting his finger on something, don't shake it off. And we're going to go to communion, but we're going to do it with joy, but also with a bit of solemnness. Because today, I want you to really think about the gift you've been given. Nothing anyone's ever done to you is more than you've done to God, because He's fully perfect, and the divide between one sin and Him is greater than He can bear. And yet He crossed that divide. And He took on our shame and our pain and our tears and our hurts along the way. Let's pray that prayer that He taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. If you're hungry and thirsty for His love and forgiveness, and if you're willing to say, empower me to carry that forward, come to this table. The body of Christ, the blood of Christ. Eat and drink in remembrance of Him. Let's sing this last song. Please get prayer if you need it, for forgiveness or for anything. And if you've never entered into that forgiveness at all, come. We'd love to lead you through walking with Jesus for the first time.
Stop working. You never stop. You never stop working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
We all like miracles. We all like to sing about miracles, but the greatest miracle is this. I once was lost, but now I'm found. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever should believe in him shall not perish, but have life everlasting. That's the truest of all miracles. Everything stems from that, and it's all about forgiveness. So may the God who is eager to forgive, may the God who will empower you to forgive in a miraculous way you can't even fathom on your own, may he bless you this week. May he keep you this week. May he cause his face to shine on you this week, and may he give you peace this week wherever you go. Be empowered, people. You carry the presence of the living God. Go out and live like it, and the world will crane its neck to see what's up. See you next week.